Thank you. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The next item of business is a debate on motion 2740 in the name of Kate Forbes on addressing the impact of labour shortages on Scotland's economy. I would invite those members who wish to speak in this debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Kate Forbes, Cabinet Secretary, to speak to and to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today I'm asking Parliament to agree to urgent and joint action to address the labour market challenges that we're facing as a result of COVID and Brexit. The Scottish Government has been actively working to resolve these challenges over a matter of months, but we do need the help and the support of this Parliament and of the UK Government. And that's why I'm calling on the Parliament to support the Government's work to protect the provision of services and the delivery of goods through our supply chains, and calling on the UK Government to commit to establishing a joint task force on labour market shortages with the Scottish Government. We need action, we need engagement from the UK Government, we need a migration system that works for Scotland, and yet it's clear that the UK immigration system is not meeting Scottish businesses and the wider Scottish economy's needs. And instead of engaging constructively with us on how to develop a system that works, we've had to make 19 requests before the Immigration Minister was even willing to attend a meeting. Immigration impacts on our economy, on our public services and on our communities. And we need a commitment to genuine, ongoing engagement. And we need a migration policy that's tailored to Scotland's distinct needs. Employers across many sectors and regions of the economy are facing continued workforce challenges, and I can't imagine that there's a single MSP in this chamber who hasn't been confronted by those issues directly from businesses in their constituencies.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving me, and while I quite agree that Brexit has had an impact on migration, does she not agree with me that in order to address these issues fully, you have to look at the underlying issues, which include workforce participation and long-term productivity, both of which are factors which predate COVID and predate Brexit?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the member makes some really important points about the structural challenges, but he can't ignore the fact that these issues have come to a head in the last few months in particular. And we've seen over the course of the last year, probably in every part of the United Kingdom, a really significant challenge facing businesses. Just before this debate, I was meeting with the Scottish Tourism Alliance council members, and they were citing data that pre-Omicron and probably after Omicron, one of the biggest challenges they have is being able to recruit and being able to ensure that they can trade fully as a result of having a full workforce. And I will, Presiding Officer, come on to specific sectoral examples. In the latest published data, which is, yes, I will.
Murdo Fraser.
I'm very grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for giving way. In November, Sebastian Bazin, who is the head of the Accor Hotel Group, was quoted in the French press as saying that the French hotel industry was on its knees due to staff shortages. Why does the Scottish Government persist in blaming these issues on Brexit when they're happening right across Europe and indeed right across the Western world?
What I think is absolutely remarkable is that notwithstanding the fact that I accept that our challenges across the world as a result of COVID, what I don't understand is why the Conservatives want to make it worse by removing freedom of movement and ensuring that the solutions to some of these problems are denied to Scottish businesses. And that is the problem at the heart of the motion that we have today and this debate. Because in the latest published data, which is from November 2021, over one third of Scottish businesses reported experience a shortage of workers. Candidate supply for permanent jobs also reached an all-time low in the same month. And almost half of businesses in the accommodation and food sector reported difficulties filling vacancies during the period, as did more than half of construction, health and social care, transport and storage businesses. Instead of wishing away those figures and the acute impact on businesses, I come to the Chamber today to try and find solutions And one of those solutions is ensuring that we have freedom of movement and a migration system that works for Scottish businesses. While some of these issues are not new, they have been severely exacerbated.
Excuse me, Cabinet Secretary, over... second. Mr. Fraser, I don't know if you wish to seek another intervention rather than from a sedentary position intervening.
Well, but I've not granted it.
It would be up to the Cabinet Secretary, not me. Cabinet
Thank
Secretary,
you,
please resume.
Presiding Officer, I think I will continue being 2 pages in and 4 minutes in. While some of these issues are not new, they have been severely exacerbated by the situation over the last year. And time and again, this government has argued that Brexit would be a disruptive force to Scotland's society and economy. 2 years on, that has clearly been the case, and there are very few who would argue it hasn't been. The ending of freedom of movement has made it more difficult for those sectors who have traditionally relied on EU citizens. For many EU citizens, Brexit, together with the narrative from the UK government, has changed their relationship with the UK. We want to support EU citizens and help them stay here. So we're providing information, advice and support through the Stay in Scotland campaign. But EU citizens should never have been forced to apply to retain the rights that they already had. We've explored the option of providing physical proof of status for EU citizens, but it's not within devolved power. So we'll continue to press the UK government to provide physical proof and to safeguard the rights of EU citizens. I'd love to, but I've made so little progress in my speech that perhaps later on. While there remains a strong business demand for staff across the economy, businesses continue to suffer from a low number of applicants overall, and that has further exacerbated existing pressures around shortages of materials and workers and amplified mismatches between supply and demand caused by the pandemic. So what are we doing about it, Presiding Officer? Well, in June, the Minister for Just Transition, Employment and Fair Work outlined how employers across a variety of sectors were struggling to recruit workers into business-critical roles. At the time, employers in food and drink manufacturing reported an unprecedented drop in the availability of workers over the first 6 months of 2021, while a shortage of around 76,000 HGV drivers across the UK meant that many supermarkets were struggling to keep their shelves well stocked. Many businesses in the accommodation and food sector also entered the busy holiday period without the number of staff they needed to meet customer demand, and 1 in 5 small businesses reported that they could close or have to radically change their business model due to the increased difficulty in recruiting EU workers at the time. And so we have been working with businesses over that time and employers to develop and implement mitigation measures in response to these shortages. We've developed a Working with Business Action Plan, which identifies new and existing actions that can be taken forward alongside business and partners, such as skills agencies. And the plan aims to mitigate the impact of those shortages and help to stimulate economic recovery through a range of employability, skills and sector-specific interventions. And that approach aligns with the National Strategy for Economic Transformation, which will set out the government's plans for strengthening Scotland's economy through national and regional action over the next 10 years. We'll work with business, education providers and enterprise and skills agencies to address sector-specific recruitment and retention challenges, including current and emerging skills and labour shortages. And as part of those measures, the Government and Skills Development Scotland is working with a range of sectors to support future workforce planning. Skills Development Scotland is working in conjunction with appointed childcare training providers to develop and deliver a taster programme in childcare for those over 25 who have been made redundant or face the risk of redundancy and for returners to the labour market. That enables those individuals to apply for entry-level positions in the childcare sector while addressing the retention and the recruitment challenges which private and third sector providers are facing. SDS is also working with Quality Meat Scotland on a project to encourage young people into the sector. The project aims to future-proof the red meat industry by ensuring that there is a pipeline of employees who have the skills and the knowledge to provide a workforce for the industry. And to pick on another sector, through our manufacturing recovery plan, we're working in collaboration with the industry, academia, business organisations and trade unions to deliver a set of targeted actions against 4 key priorities, one of those being skills and workforce. The National Transition Training funding of £1.98 million for the National Manufacturing Institute Scotland also directly supports this priority. And that's in addition to the earlier establishment of the Manufacturing Skills Academy as a key element of our £75 million investment in the Institute. We recognise how vital the manufacturing sector is, as well as the childcare sector and the red meat industry, how vital they all are to Scotland's recovery and just transition. And we look forward to the opening of the Institute's headquarters in the autumn. Presiding Officer, we need to identify how to support people into key jobs. And we're committed to supporting young people from all backgrounds into the labour market to ensure they have the right skills to succeed. The Construction Recovery Plan recognises that a particular focus is needed on the younger workforce and on getting apprentices back into work and learning. Our work to align the Young Person's Guarantee with sector and employer needs will also open the door to more career opportunities for young people, including in sectors with current or emerging shortages. And through the summer marketing campaign, we've highlighted the diverse job opportunities available within the tourism sector, promoting tourism as a career of choice for young people and attracting new talent. And we've also mirrored that approach with our recent national marketing campaign, There's More to Care Than Caring, which ran from mid-November to December and showed the benefits of a career in adult social care to a younger audience. And so, Presiding Officer, I touch on these examples within specific sectors of the importance of understanding the particular issues that they face and then putting in place tangible and meaningful interventions that try and help resolve the issue. Staff shortages pose significant challenges to businesses, requiring them to become competitive in their offer to employees. But also by adopting fair work principles and investing in upskilling and training, employers are developing a more sustainable and a more competitive approach to recruiting and retaining workers. The Scottish Government is supporting those very employers to create fairer workplaces and promoting a sectoral approach through the Fair Work Convention's inquiries into social care and construction and the planned inquiry into hospitality. And fair work will be central to our national strategy. Despite all of that work, and I wanted to start by outlining all of the work that we are doing to tackle skills and labour shortages, many businesses and employers are still struggling due to the reduction in freedom of movement and the impact on labour mobility and supply and pandemic-related disruption. The emergence of Omicron has also brought further challenges and insecurity for many industries, exacerbating existing staff shortages. While staff shortages and recruitment challenges are being recorded across all sectors, it's particularly pronounced in certain industries and sectors.
Cabinet Secretary, could you bring your
remarks? I will bring that to a close. And so, Presiding Officer, as I draw this debate to a close, the call, as I said at the outset, is to work across Parliament and hopefully across governments to try and bring a meaningful resolution to the challenges that businesses face. Because as we emerge from COVID and as we move into living with COVID, the issue of staff shortages will still be an issue that we need to resolve.
Thank you. And Cabinet Secretary, could you move the motion, please?
Motion in my name.
Thank you very much. I now call on Liz Smith to speak to and to move Amendment 2740.1. Up to 7 minutes, please, Liz Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And may I move the amendment in my name? And can I acknowledge at the start of this debate that Brexit has undoubtedly been responsible for some of the current issues in the labour market? Some of them are serious. And I don't think anyone should try to deny that or make light of the problems that have been encountered, because we all have constituents, many in rural and farming communities, who have been expressing very grave concerns about key aspects of that, including the shortages of migrant labour. And I particularly cite fruit and vegetable and berry picking in my own regional area as examples. And these people are absolutely right to state these concerns. But, you know, if you looked at this motion and if you listened to the SNP over many debates in this place, you would think that Brexit is responsible for all the labour market issues, and that is simply untrue. Indeed, my colleague Murdo Fraser, I think, was asking the Cabinet Secretary about the French situation, because clearly that is not something that is a Brexit issue. Indeed, I won't just now, if you don't mind. Indeed, I think there is plenty of evidence to hand to demonstrate that several of the current problems existed long before Brexit, long before COVID indeed, because one needs only to take a cursory look at the evidence that is supplied to the Finance Committee of this Parliament from bodies like the Scottish Fiscal Commission, mentioned by the Labour motion amendment, rather, or the Fraser of Allender Institute, to recognise that there are far more, much more deep-seated problems at stake here. And let me outline just some of them. Firstly, there are inherent structural weaknesses in the Scottish labour market, which have created skills shortages and insecure employment in some key sectors, and which, together with a higher-than-average ageing population, are creating very serious challenges, impacting on the potential for stronger economic growth and long-term investment. And these are not issues that have been created by Brexit, but by SNP ministers refusing sometimes to listen to the business community and failing to put in place policies which will address these problems. Now, I know that some of my colleagues will talk more about the detail of these failures, for example, to close the skills gap, to widen the apprenticeship opportunities, to help employers to both upskill and reskill in the workforce. But we know that Scotland is currently... Yes, I will.
Richard Lockhead.
Member for giving way. Will the member acknowledge that some of the deep-seated problems and structural problems that Scotland faces are the responsibility of previous Conservative governments who have left us with intergenerational challenges in our communities, and that's why we're in part of this position today?
Liz Smith.
I think if the Minister cares to look at what the Scottish Fiscal Commission is saying, he will say that the greatest concern is the long-term skills gap in IT and technology companies, and the Chambers of Commerce, who I think, if I'm right in saying, it was 47% of employers in Scotland are saying that there is a lack of suitable talent for their businesses, which obviously has detrimental growth. That is not something that is to do with the UK. Secondly, there are serious productivity issues. If we track back to 2007, we can see that we have consistently been lagging behind other OECD nations, despite the SNP's bold pledges that it would get Scotland into the top quartile when it came to productivity. 16th out of 37 is hardly that, and we remain below the median for the OECD and for the rest of the UK. And again, that has serious implications for growth. Witnesses at the committee have flagged up that whilst we have the potential to improve productivity, and we do, including a generally well-educated labour force, there has neither been the right approach to innovation from this SNP government, nor the assistance that is required by employers who want to improve their business structures. And I think the Scottish Government, or maybe perhaps more accurately their coalition partners, the Greens, they should be very careful about what they say in this debate. After all, their approach to oil and gas is hardly what is helping matters when it comes to labour market issues, and I believe deep down that many of them know that. And then there is the demographic issue. Both the Scottish Fiscal Commission and the Fraser of Allender Institute demonstrate that Scotland has a population that is ageing more quickly than in other parts of the UK and in EU nations, with the result that there are higher rates of economic activity, as well as obviously a greater burden for social security on taxpayers. But the really big issue which results from this is the weakness in the Scottish tax take. We know that the net effect of the current tax revenue is negative to the tune of £190 million, but we also know, much more worryingly, that the prediction for 2026-27 is that that could rise to £417 million. And that has worrying signs about tax elasticities as well. So the decline in the percentage share of the working population and the total within the total population is a really serious issue, because the devolved tax take in Scotland as a proportion of the total tax take is declining, which is, together with predicted problems in social security, where obviously that spending has got to increase, that paints a very unhappy long-term outlook. And Brexit is by no means the root cause of that. Of course, if Brexit was the main cause of the problem, then it would not be the case that those nations still inside the EU are experiencing the same shortage problems as we are. But they are. Indeed, most developed nations are experiencing labour market shortages of various sorts. For example, yes, of course.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to Liz Smith for giving way. While in some ways I agree with the point she just made, but would she not accept that while Brexit may not be the whole reason, it certainly exacerbates every single one of the reasons she's just set out in her speech?
Liz Smith.
If the member listened to the start of my speech, I said exactly that I recognise that Brexit is part of the problem. But what I am saying very clearly is that it is not something that can be related to Scotland, the UK only. There are other countries within the EU who are having exactly the same problems as we are, so it cannot be a Brexit problem. That's the whole point about this, that we can't just blame it on Brexit when clearly people who are still inside the EU are having exactly the same problems. Now, my colleagues will set out some of the things that we can do about this, things that we ought to be putting in place in terms of a policy commitment. But I really come back to this point, and I will finish on this point, that there are long-term structural issues within the Scottish economy which are predating Brexit and COVID many years ago, and therefore they cannot be held responsible just because of Brexit or COVID. And that is a very serious message that's coming from every single economic forecaster that you care to listen to, and I think that the Cabinet Secretary needs to listen to them.
Thank you. I now call on Paul Sweeney to speak to and move Amendment 2740.2. Up 6 minutes, please, Mr Sweeney.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and it's a pleasure to open today's debate for the Labour Party and to move the amendment in my name. It's impossible not to see the impact the labour shortages have had on the Scottish economy. I think that was clear from the Minister, the Cabinet Secretary's speech. We see it in our supermarkets, at the petrol pumps, and many other scenarios we encounter on a daily basis. So I'd like to start on that point of consensus. The Scottish Government refers to the impact of exiting the EU on labour supplies and calls on the UK Government to scrap their damaging migration policies. Well, I wholeheartedly agree. Brexit is a causal factor of the labour shortages we are experiencing, and they will undoubtedly be exacerbated by the frankly risible and harmful attitude to immigration that dominates Tory thinking. And I thought it was telling from the Conservative spokesperson that despite the conciliatory language, the Conservative Party have still removed any mention of Brexit from their amendment to the motion, which I find troubling given they have just admitted the fact that that is a major issue that we have to contend with. And while it is undoubtedly a crucial factor, it is not the only reason, and that much I do agree. The pandemic itself has exposed the underlying vulnerability and fragility of the Scottish economy. And while the pandemic may have exposed those fragilities, they are in part caused by an underlying lack of an industrial strategy, one that actually underpins upskilling, increases productivity, and makes strategic public investments. It's also just not credible for the Scottish Government to blame this challenge on Brexit entirely. For 15 years, the Scottish Government have been in power, and for 15 years, we have had a slow erosion of Scottish economic sovereignty. Domestic ownership of industry has steadily decreased. Low business start-up rates, predatory foreign investment dramatically increasing at the expense of public investment, and a complete over-reliance on imported labour that is largely low-skilled and ununionised, thus generally exerting further downward pressure on wages. We've had warnings from the Scottish Fiscal Commission illustrating the scale of the challenge that faces the Scottish economy as a result of the pandemic. As a country, we have lagged behind the rest of the UK on PAYE employment and pay growth. Labour market participation and employment has been growing more slowly in Scotland than the rest of the UK. And in Scotland, the number of employees per head of population has grown by just 0.6% compared to 2.3% in the rest of the UK. And I know some of my colleagues will elaborate on other challenges facing the Scottish economy, particularly in relation to productivity and inequalities that are observable across many sectors of industry. So I would like to focus on the skill. I have to give way.
Richard Lockhead.
Can I thank the member for giving way? And whilst I think many people in the chamber across all parties would agree with many of the symptoms that you diagnose with the Scottish economy over past decades, will accept that many of the employment levers and economic levers are not within the responsibility of this Parliament, and therefore we should try and get them transferred to Holyrood so we can do something about these challenges that he outlines.
Paul Sweeney.
Well, I'd like to focus on very much what is in the grasp of this Parliament to achieve, and that's what my focus in the speech will be. And I certainly want to focus particularly in my speech on the skills gap, and that's something I'm sure we can meet some degree of consensus on. During the last 15 years of this government, there has been a steady decline in Scottish employees receiving job-related training and persistent sector-specific skills gaps that have become increasingly prevalent, and some of them were referred to in previous speeches. And it's not just my partisan assertion here. The Scottish Government's own advisory group on economic recovery stated in June 2020 that there are persistent skill shortages sitting alongside graduate underemployment. So it's hardly surprising that upskilling and skills development has fallen by the wayside under this government, because just before Christmas, the budget revealed further cuts to Skills Development Scotland, over £5 million cut from their overall budget, £10 million cut from the employability and skills budget, and a real terms cut to the education and skills budget. So we've seen similar financial pressure faced by our colleges too, which should be the engine room of a resilient, adaptable, high-skilled workforce. Indeed, I was speaking to Glasgow Kelvin College about this only yesterday, and they are concerned that new skills training funding is tied up in bureaucratic red tape and unable to be drawn down to meet the day-to-day challenges they face, such as redesigning their provision to provide tailored training for local businesses and industries and actually get people into the workforce and reskilled. And also, they're finding it very difficult to keep people in training programmes because of the domestic pressures they're facing due to lockdown restrictions. So in my view, it's quite straightforward. You don't build a motivated, skilled, productive workforce on the cheap. You don't build a flourishing industry through neglect. And you don't build resilient economic growth through complacence. Deputy Presiding Officer, our amendment today attempts to address some of these issues. It urges the Scottish Government to provide a robust industrial strategy fit for the 21st century, something I've personally been advocating for nearly a decade. It recognises the need to address the gross inequalities we see arising as a result of low pay and poor conditions, and a failure to fully utilise fair work practices that are entirely within the remit of the Scottish Government. And finally, it urges government to fundamentally reconsider its relationship with employers, business organisations, trade unions, colleges and universities. For far too long, we have been content with our public sector and its development agencies being passive and investing public money as a last resort. I know, because I worked for Scottish Enterprise for 2 years. I've seen it personally, and I've seen the weaknesses that that organisation has, despite the great people working for it. It has resulted in numerous failed industrial interventions, like Ferguson Marine in Port Glasgow, the Calais Railway Works in Springburn, and most recently, Prestwick Airport. So why is it that we are hesitant to use the power of the state to improve the lives of people across our country and to bolster our economy? We need a shift towards a far more entrepreneurial state that takes proactive investments, that sees that investment as an opportunity to improve people's quality of life and to further their potential, to seed economic sovereignty in Scotland. Deputy Presiding Officer, I would urge colleagues across the chamber to support our amendment today. It refocuses our efforts collectively on addressing that skills gap, increasing productivity, and to focus our fundamental and singular economic priority on investment-led growth. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sweeney. And have you moved your amendment, please?
At the beginning, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Right. Apologies. Thank you. Okay, and I now call Willie Rennie, who is joining us remotely. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr. Rennie.
Even as a bit of a Eurofanatic fanatic, I accept that the workforce shortages are not just about Brexit. I think the Conservative government would do well to listen to the more balanced approach of Liz Smith today, because Brexit certainly has made this situation worse. To the SNP, don't hide behind Brexit or the pandemic, as the deep-rooted problems have been mounting for years. But let me first focus on the issue of immigration policy, which I believe is stopping industries recovering from the pandemic. Plain and simple. They deprive British businesses of the workforce that they need to rebuild the economy, the lorry drivers to supplier shops and supermarkets, the workers for our care homes, farms and the hospitality sector. Take my favourite subject, the berry fields of Fife. The new growing techniques demand more workers for longer periods. The sector has tried to recruit locally, but there are just not enough people locally to recruit. For them, we need a bigger seasonal worker scheme that works. This is not just also about the farms. If you look at companies like Kettle Produce, who supply the supermarkets right across the country, the seasonal worker scheme needs to be extended to cover them as well. The hit on the fruit and veg sector in Fife alone stretches to millions of pounds for this year alone. The rotting berries and the veg left in the fields this year is unlikely to be repeated next year, because the farmers are just not going to invest in the crop unless they can be guaranteed that they've got the workforce, and they haven't been. The pleas for a bigger seasonal worker scheme have been ignored by the UK government. To limit it to 30,000 visas, half of what is required, is bad enough, but for it to be tapered down from next year, I think is utterly reckless. The Conservative government should just be honest with businesses, honest that they are prepared to accept casualties, business failures, and for Scotland to produce and process less of its own food. They should be honest that they don't care about food security anymore. But the sleekest way that they are going about this shows the Conservatives are obsessed with immigration policy rather than standing up for the economy and businesses. And on a wider basis, we need to get rid of the arbitrary salary threshold of £25,000, which doesn't recognise unskilled workers as key workers. They should be valued. We also need to have the youth mobility scheme extended to EU citizens, a 12-month visa for the food and drink supply chain, and we must allow workers to recruit the workers, the employers and the workers that they need in order to get us out of this crisis. It is positive that care workers are to be added to the Home Office's shortage occupation list. But this is too late and too timid. The Conservative government needs to think again and offer a three-year visa for carers with immediate effect. But the Scottish government also bears some responsibility for our current predicament in social care. These are the problems that have been brewing for years, well before Brexit. And it's in large part because the SNP government will not fund social care sufficiently so it can give decent wages for carers. The social care sector is on its knees. People are waiting in hospital, at home, without the care packages that they need. And the reason for this is pure and simple. The SNP have been taking carers for granted for far too long. The Scottish Fiscal Commission has found that Scotland's economy is lagging behind the rest of the UK because of declining labour market participation, weak investment in productivity, and insufficient flexibility in skills development. These have been long-running issues, evident well before the pandemic and, of course, well before Brexit. It is right that we need an industrial strategy that addresses regional inequalities, low pay, poor conditions and the skills gaps. That's why we're going to support cancel, because it takes out any reference to Brexit.
Mr Rennie, could you bring your remarks to a close, please?
Just finishing.
Yeah, because we're also struggling to sound. Mr Rennie, the sound system is breaking down, so really, if you could conclude.
All of this is a fight for the longer term health of our economy.
Mr Rennie, I'm afraid we're going to have to stop you there. Apologies also because there's something going wrong with the sound system, which was present to an extent during the rest of your remarks, but fortunately we managed to get most of your contribution. Thank you very much. And I now move to the open debate. Before I do so, could I remind all members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and the person I'm looking at is not looking at me. And I now call Michelle Thompson, who's joining us remotely. Up to 4 minutes, please, Ms Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'll watch with interest today how the opposition parties, despite their softer stance today, vote on this motion, focusing on Scottish business, their employees, growing the jobs market and developing the wider economy. Now, I've got some sympathy with the calls for an industrial strategy from the Labour Party in Scotland, but look forward with interest to hearing how they will protect economic development in the light of the threats posed by the Internal Market Act and the Subsidy Control Bill, and where their answer is always Westminster knows best. As for the Tory amendment, despite the undoubtedly well-intentioned acknowledgement from Liz Smith, it fundamentally seeks to remove the wording regarding the impact of Brexit on Scottish business and ignores the problems created by Tory policies on immigration. Can I gently warn them? The Scottish Tories will not be forgiven for sitting supine and soporific in allowing the charlatan that is their leader, Boris Johnston, to inflict this damage. There are two main areas today I'll focus on. The first is international competitiveness. I want Scotland to be a leading international player in a number of areas, and particularly those that support our net zero ambitions, such as developing the hydrogen economy. We want to be at the top of the food chain in selected emerging technologies with a higher wage, higher skilled economy than at the present time. And I welcome the Scottish Government's commitment to invest an additional £500 million over this Parliament for new, good, green jobs. However, the consequences of Brexit, and particularly the deliberate choice of the UK Government in restricting access to labour from Europe, presents a severe threat to many businesses, not least, as mentioned by others, hospitality, construction and tourism, including those that export and those in new technologies. Surely all cross-party MSPs can add their voice to the multiple organisations such as the FSB, COSLA, Royal Society of Edinburgh and so on that support the call from the Scottish Government for a new temporary worker route. Brexit harms our productivity, and we can all agree that both Scottish and UK productivity needs to be better. Critically, Brexit reduces the available working age labour market pool precisely at a time of emerging skills gaps. So if we are to be internationally competitive, we need to be able to attract the highly skilled to Scotland as well as train our own population to the highest of standards. My second area of concern relates to how best to serve our international class businesses across a variety of sectors. In my own constituency of Falkirk East, this includes businesses such as Piramal and Fujifilm. They are reliant on access to high quality skills development for their staff to ensure they maintain their competitive edge and continually improve their productivity. I've previously spoken of the need to pursue excellence, as called for by the likes of the Cumberford Little report, authored at the behest of the Scottish Government by the principals of Edinburgh and Glasgow City Colleges, and supported widely across the college sector. They invite us to move beyond competence and drive up standards in pursuit of excellence. They're not alone. The Scottish Director of World Skills has made similar calls, and they are calls we need to heed to ensure our businesses and their employees have access to the skills needed to remain internationally competitive. Presiding Officer, in closing, I fully support the actions of the Scottish Government, and I hope they agree with me that combined action to mitigate the damage being done by Brexit is clear, and to strive for excellence in skills are part of the way forward for Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call Donald Cameron to be followed by Jim Fairley. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Let me start by agreeing with the Cabinet Secretary that the issue of labour shortages in key sectors of our economy is a serious one, and it deserves a proper debate. But it is disappointing, although perhaps not unsurprising, that despite 5.5 years passing since the Brexit vote, the SNP continue to pin most of the blame on Brexit, rather than acknowledge their own failings on this issue and the fact that labour shortages are a global problem. We may be in a new year and looking to the future, but it's clear the SNP are looking to the past and focusing on old grievances. As Liz Smith and others have pointed out in their remarks, this is a complex issue and one which is multifactorial. It can't be attributed to one reason alone. Now, that's not to say that Brexit hasn't played some part. Yes, it has. But I've made this point in debates in the past. Labour shortages across various sectors existed long before Brexit. And this morning I spoke to workers in the maritime sector who were talking about recruitment and retention. No mention of Brexit at all. And it's undoubtedly true that the pandemic has played a major role in exacerbating this problem. And that's on top of the many pre-existing issues that have resulted in labour shortages in different countries and across different sectors across the world. And the OECD noted in the 2021 International Migration Outlook that changes to COVID rules are preventing the settling of labour markets. And that's resulted in a 30% drop in migration to countries worldwide. So we should use this debate to examine those deep-rooted problems and do what we can to resolve them. We know that this is a global crisis and that countries as diverse as America, Australia and China are all experiencing labour shortages. The EU is facing similar challenges. And as Deloitte noted last year, the heightened risk of contracting COVID has made certain jobs riskier than others. And employers in those industries find it more challenging to attract workers at pre-pandemic pay rates, with industries such as hospitalities particularly impacted. Domestically, there are fears that Scotland will experience a massive worker shortage by 2030. And the think tank IPPR Scotland has estimated that we're likely to have a gap of 410,000 workers by that date. Now, that is hugely concerning. And we face a significant challenge. But the Scottish Government has to play a role in preventing these scenarios from playing out in the long term. And I think the Scottish Chambers of Commerce made a very interesting point where they talked about firms being worried about the skills of candidates that are coming forward, not simply the lack of candidates. There is a distinction between a skills shortage and a labour shortage, and I think that's particularly significant. According to, I would normally, but I have a very short time to speak. According to a CIPD report, they note that apprenticeships could play a stronger role in addressing labour shortages, and improving the supply of apprentices is an urgent priority given severe disruption to apprenticeship activity last year. And the Scottish Conservatives agree with this. That's why we outlined proposals in April last year for unlimited demand-led apprenticeships, which would be based on employers' needs. And we also call for the creation of a £500 right to retrain account for every Scottish adult, which would give people the ability to retrain and upskill in order to be more competitive in a modern workforce. And if ever there was a moment to turbocharge the skills agenda and focus on reskilling and upskilling, then this is it. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, those are some of our solutions to resolving the issue of labour shortages in our economy. And we will stand ready to support any meaningful measure which will help reduce the skills gap and create economic growth to the benefit of the people of Scotland.
Thank you very much, Mr Cameron. And I call on Jim Fairley to be followed by Sarah Boyack. In 4 minutes, Mr Fairley, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I want to begin by welcoming the fact that there is one part of the motion that neither of the amendments seek to delete or to alter, and that is the recognition that is made of the resilience and innovation shown by employers and workers across the country and across many sectors of the economy in the face of the most incredible challenges as a consequence of the global pandemic. Unfortunately, the unanimity doesn't last long because the Tory amendment clearly tries to airbrush the role of Brexit out. Now, I'd like to congratulate Liz Smith for accepting that point, because she's clearly speaking to the same people that I'm speaking to in my constituency of Perthshire South and Kinrossia. She's hearing from hospitality industry, from the butchery business, from the soft fruit sector. And she also talked about the long-term structural challenges. And I would accept there are long-term structural challenges in Scotland, but I would say they predate the devolution. They go right back to Thatcher's years when she decimated whole communities throughout Scotland, and we're still living with the effects of that to this day. Now, I've told the Chamber before about the discussions I have had with Gleneagles Hotel, Keith Hydro and Simon Howie Butchers, three extremely important businesses in my constituency, and they've made it very clear to me that to operate at full capacity, they need to close a staffing shortfall of up to 25%, and they have to be able to recruit beyond our borders to do so. Now, I wrote on their behalf to the UK government, but the reply was firmly negative. It was not that they don't get or know what the problems are or what is needed to address them. It's that they're choosing not to help. They're just choosing not to hear it, and they're refusing to take the responsibility for it. Now, the problems might be inevitable consequences of the situation in which we now find ourselves with the pandemic, but they were not unavoidable. They're the consequence of decisions knowingly taken by the Conservative Party in the UK government. The choices they made and the decisions they took have left us where we are now. It's just not that they chose to rip Scotland out of the EU, despite overwhelmingly expressed view of the Scottish people not to be. It's not that they chose to embark on a harder Brexit than those put in the Leave case said would happen. And it's what the country is careering towards a hard Brexit cliff edge. They chose not to apply the brakes, even when the totally unexpected hit. Now, nobody knew that we were going to face a global pandemic. And it has made it extremely tough for many of those sectors in the economy excuse me, who then had to deal with the double whammy. But as James Withers wrote in Scotland Food and Drink on Twitter in August, Brexit has been an enormous shock to the labour market, a Brexit implemented in the middle of a pandemic when supply chains were already straining. Now, I know that all other members will have received the same briefing as I have from the National Farmers Union of Scotland, and Willie Rennie was talking about it earlier on, in advance of this debate, that, and you don't have to have a farming background to understand the grim picture that they paint. They're simply farmers who are not going to plant this year because they cannot guarantee a labour force for next year. And the labour shortages in 21 meant that these farmers had lost huge amounts of money. And that is the start of a vicious circle if they're not going to plant for next year. It's not just farming and food and hospitality. We've got bus companies are cutting back on services because they simply cannot recruit enough drivers. And if we look at the shortage of HGV drivers, the problem is not just the ending of freedom of movement with our leaving of the EU or the employer's aversion to the extra paperwork that is now needed. The UK government deliberately created a toxic environment for immigration across the board. And this country needs immigration. I will do, yeah.
The member's just about to wind up, but Ms White, very, very briefly.
I'll be very quick. Thank you. Thank you for taking my intervention. Would the member not...
Please address comments.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the member not agree that the issue with HGV drivers is not just for Scotland and the UK? There's an issue across Europe as a whole.
Jim Fairley.
Yes, I would absolutely agree that there's an issue across the whole. But why make it harder by introducing a hard Brexit? And if I am going to be coming to the end of my speech, President, I will move on very quickly. I think more and more people are coming to recognise that it is only through the normal powers of having a normal nation that this country of ours can take the decisions that our people need. And this debate underlines the importance of securing our independence and engaging properly with the people and countries of the world. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Fairley. I now call on Sarah Boyack to be followed by Paul McLennan. 4 minutes, please, Ms Boyack.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Colleagues across the Chamber today are rightly raising the real business concerns across Scotland, which have been made worse not only by Brexit, but also by COVID-19. So I want to thank the Food and Drink Federation Scotland for their very helpful briefing for today's debate, which has noted that we've now reached a crisis point with the growth and viability of businesses in danger and with knock-on impacts for consumers impacting with very high food price inflation. And the briefing also highlighted that in a survey carried out last August, 97% of businesses said they felt they would struggle to fill vacancies in the future. That is a shocking statistic, and it highlights just how dire the situation is. But as several colleagues have mentioned today, the labour shortages are a result of multiple causes, and we cannot just blame COVID or Brexit. They are key, but that's not the whole story. Many of the factors driving failures in the Scottish economy predate the pandemic and have gone unaddressed during the entire time of the SNP's time in office, and we are also lagging behind the rest of the UK. Before COVID, as Paul Sweeney eloquently noted, Scotland's economy had been suffering from low investment and productivity, limited local and community ownership, and increasing inequalities in our labour market for over a decade. And that's why Scottish Labour has previously called on the Scottish Government to work with the UK Government to create a flexible visa scheme. And we're not asking to reinvent the wheel. It's time to look at the steps we've taken in the past, look at the experience from the Fresh Talent Scheme that was introduced under former First Minister Jack McConnell's regime. But it's also clear that while we need flexibility, we also can't rely totally on imported labour. And we've got to look at the homegrown crisis we have in Scotland. And I wanted particularly to raise the issue of fair work and childcare. And our Labour amendment highlights the need for an industrial strategy that addresses regional inequalities, low pay, poor conditions and the skills gaps we have right across Scotland. We had a steady decline in employees in Scotland receiving job-related training over the past 15 years, and slow wage rises are also reflected in poverty data. If you look at data for 2015 to 18, it showed that 60% of working-age adults in Scotland living in relative poverty after housing costs lived in working households, the highest on record. In-work poverty is also a major driver of child poverty, with the proportion of children in Scotland living in relative poverty also rising. And that is before we take into account recent food and fuel cost rises. If you look at the gender inequalities, in 2018, the gap between the employment rates of women and men in the workforce was nearly 8%. Between disabled and non-disabled people, it was nearly 36%. And between white people and people from ethnic minority groups, it was nearly 20%, the largest gap on record. So we have deep-seated inequalities in our labour market and in our communities that must be addressed with targeted action, not with headline grabbing or empty statements. It means making training available, not cutting skills development budgets. It means making childcare accessible and affordable to parents, particularly women in the community, so they can actually access those jobs, so that they know that they'll be able to turn up to work and that they will get paid enough to support their family and to pay their bills. We need to tackle those deep-seated inequalities, make sure that adjustments and support for disabled people are made right across the workforce. So tackling those inequalities in our communities, it means using government investment in jobs and training, whether at the national or the local level, working with businesses and trade unions, using procurement policies as we recover from COVID to provide more attractive employment that pays people enough to live on and with training and career development opportunities. So when we bang our desks relentlessly about care, you just need to look at the number of people who are not getting care support at the moment, because care is so unattractive, it doesn't pay well, and people can't support their families on the poor wages that they're paid. So these deep-seated inequalities need to be tackled, and we need to find a process coming out of COVID that actually gets people into work and enables them to live. And that's got to be the priority to tackle our labour inequalities.
Thank you, Ms Boyack. I now call on Paul McLennan to be followed by Maggie Chapman. 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and thanks for the opportunity to speak in this debate. The last few years have been difficult for business with the ongoing pandemic and, of course, departure from the EU. My own background is 20 years in the banking sector, 5 years in the development sector, and also I've been a councillor for 15 years and I've spoken to hundreds of businesses all over the county in the last year or so. In all my time engaging with business, the very clear feedback is that this is the most difficult period in terms of recruiting staff they've ever faced. I want to focus on a few key areas of the economy in East Lothian and the impact labour shortages are having on them. In food and drink, East Lothian led the way with the first ever sector-based business improvement district in Scotland. Queen Margaret University, along with East Lothian Council, have announced a Food and Drink Innovation Centre, funded in partnership through the Edinburgh City Region deal. Food and drink are Scotland's largest manufacturing sector, employing 44,000 people, contributing £3.6 billion gross value added to the economy, and with a turnover of over £10 billion. Skills Development Scotland forecast predicted Scottish food and drink manufacturing will need 8,700 new recruits between now and 2031. We've got some fabulous names in East Lothian, such as Billion Brewery, Glenkinchie Distillery, Luca Ice Creams, Winston Brewery and Thistle Cross Cider. If you've not tried any of them, please try them. They're all struggling in terms of trying to recruit staff at the moment. East Lothian Food and Drink, in recent discussions I had with them, have been impacted by the withdrawal from the EU in terms of its supply chain, its export opportunities and, of course, labour shortages. On in farming, there are around about 200 farms in East Lothian. Labour shortages have been a major issue in 2021, and we're in discussions with the NFU talking about this new skills strategy that they're looking at the moment. That's meant some farmers have lost their harvests. Farmers I know are now making decisions, and there's a danger that many farmers may move away from sectors such as fruit picking that are important to the economy if labour shortages remain. Previously, farmers had the ability to employ as many EU workers as possible. Research now showed that and this is from a briefing from the NFU, that they had a labour shortage on average of around about 22% this year. The key thing is the retention rate for EU workers at that period of time was over 80%. And Molly Rennie was quite right mentioning about visa numbers being restricted this year. I think it was 30,000. NFU predicted it needs to be around about 60,000. Changes are required to the immigration system to address the acute labour market shortages being faced across multiple sectors of our economy and in public sector. The Scottish Government warned about this at that particular period in time. There are changes that the UK Government could make. I think we mentioned around about the CIPD, and it's calling on the UK Government to establish a temporary job mobility scheme for young EU nationals to act as a safety valve to ease immediate acute labour shortages right across the UK, Scotland and, of course, across Europe. The Scottish Government, as has been mentioned by a few speakers this afternoon, is calling on the UK Government to immediately introduce a new temporary worker route to address acute labour shortages. We also have issues in terms of recruitment in East Lothian in terms of hospitality and social care that Sarah Boyack mentioned, in construction, food production, agriculture and, of course, tourism, which is a really important sector in East Lothian also. Changes could be implemented immediately, with opportunity for workers to switch on to other visa routes once they are in the country and have employment. That is really, really important. Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament are best placed to decide how to accommodate our distinct labour market needs. We also need to be cognisant of the opportunities and the growth of renewables that we're in Scotland, and we need proper workforce planning strategies working with the sector. The impact of the UK's immigration policy confirms the need for a tailored approach to immigration in Scotland. The Scottish Government proposals are widely supported amongst key stakeholders, and we've heard a few of them, the FSB, COSLA, SCDI, Scottish Tourism Alliance. The Scottish Government is working, as the Cabinet Secretary said, with business organisations to develop a Working with Businesses action plan. It will also engage with education providers and enterprise and skills agencies, as well as local authorities, to address sector-specific recruitment and retention challenges. And closing, the best way to tackle this is Scotland's future in our own hands is the only way to have a migration policy fit for purpose. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McLennan. I now call Maggie Chapman to be followed by Colette Stevenson. 4 minutes, please, Ms Chapman.
Thank you. The last 21 months have taught us much about resilience. Our resilience, or otherwise, as human beings, and the resilience, or otherwise, of the systems and structures that support us. And we have had some uncomfortable truths laid bare, too. Our economy currently does not support everyone the way it should. Our politics often fails to provide security and safety to everyone, and our society is profoundly unequal. As we plan and develop an economy that needs to be robust in the face of future shocks, whilst supporting individuals and communities equitably and fairly, I think we must address at least two significant issues, which both speak directly to addressing the problem of labour shortages in different parts of our economy. First, we must make work fair. I do not disagree with the calls from Labour for a focus on fair work. We must all work with employers and trade unions to secure genuine improvements in pay and conditions. We must address low pay, in-work poverty, poor flexibility and inequalities in the workplace. No worker should suffer precarious contracts. We need better sick pay. COVID has made that very clear. We need strong trade unions with real bargaining power. And I remain so disappointed that it was Labour, back in 2014 during the Smith Commission, who vetoed the devolution of employment law. But there are things we can do and have started to do in Scotland. I believe our social security system will support people better. I just wish we had the powers to introduce things like a universal basic income. But we will, one day. We need to ensure that all workers have access to the training and development opportunities they want and need to deal with issues like the much-needed just transition to renewable energy, but also to allow workers to adapt and be flexible as technological innovations and automation remove some aspects of their roles. Secondly, we must have the right data and information about the things we need to understand and use this to plan effectively. We must better understand the differences and intersections between skills shortages and labour gaps. We must better understand workers' expectations about their employment. We must better understand how things vary geographically and regionally and what impacts demographic changes will have, and so on. And we need institutions and organisations that understand these data and can turn them into effective planning and actions. We have known for many years, for instance, about the challenges we face in social care due to demographic shifts, yet we have not always effectively planned for these changes and challenges. Similarly, we know our future economy will be reliant on jobs in green industries. So now we must ensure we provide the right education, training and skills development for people to fill these jobs. But it is not just about having people with the right skills. Our planning must take account of other issues too. Where will people live? Where will their children go to school? Where will they be able to access healthcare? And so on. We hear time and time again across different sectors that the limiting factor for recruitment is affordable housing. And there are going to be shifts and shocks in the future that we still need to properly identify. That is why I think we should explore the creation of a foresighting centre, one of the recommendations of the Royal Society of Edinburgh's Post-COVID-19 Futures Commission, to provide an important contribution to the industrial strategies of the future. In closing, Presiding Officer, there are many more issues I would want to address in this debate, but I'll make my final point about immigration. It seems to me that, for many Conservatives, Brexit was about stopping the world so they could get off. But they dragged us off, too. With the other awful immigration changes we see coming at us from Westminster, I urge all of those in this chamber with any influence in the UK government to press this point wherever possible. Scotland deserves so much better than Westminster is currently providing. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Chapman. I now call on Colette Stevenson to be followed by Tess White. Again, 4 minutes, Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We all know the impact of the pandemic on the economy. In recent months, however, the labour shortage has become more and more obvious. Understaffed hotels and restaurants, empty supermarket shelves and fuel tankers with no one to drive them. As we recover, it's important that we recognise the labour and skills shortages we're seeing and understand the causes. Government must take the right action to resolve these challenges. Firstly, we are seeing just how reckless it was for the UK government to press ahead with a hard Brexit in the middle of a pandemic. Long before COVID, the Scottish Government, businesses and trade unions were telling the UK government that a hard Brexit would have a major impact on the economy, including labour shortages. When COVID struck, it was clear that the only reasonable thing would be, at the very least, would be to delay a hard Brexit. Instead, the UK government carried on. By adding another 500 million people to its hostile environment policy on migration, the Tories surely should have seen or foreseen the consequences. The UK government's point-based approach to migration doesn't value the right things. They have not considered the needs of public services and private businesses. They have fixated on high salaries rather than the skills and social value of workers. The short-term visa for HGV and poultry workers was not only embarrassingly, but more seriously, a symptom of a broken immigration system. Presiding Officer, if the Tories can't create an immigration system that works for Scotland and key business sectors, then they should devolve the powers now so that this Parliament can take those important decisions. With the powers it does have, the Scottish Government is working with businesses to develop action plans, promote fair work and address sector-specific recruitment challenges. SNP policies like the Young Persons Guarantee will support the next generation by creating more opportunities to work, study or undertake training. Through its COVID recovery strategy, the Scottish Government will also deliver an additional £500 million to support new green jobs and to equip people with the skills to work and progress in them. That combination of working to improve things now and to lay the groundwork for a better future is so crucial. It's a tale of two governments with very different visions. It's not just me and my colleagues that are sick of the UK government. Industry is fed up with it too. And perhaps the Tories have just given up on pretending that everything is good in Brexit Britain. The Food and Drink Federation Scotland said they contacted the UK and Scottish Government with their demands to support that vital sector. To date, only the Scottish Government has responded, with Mary Goujon reaffirming her commitment to promote and support the sector. Presiding Officer, the labour and skills shortages we are all experiencing demonstrates the recklessness of a hard Brexit in the middle of a pandemic. The Scottish Government is working hard within its powers to support business recovery, promote fair work and boost skills. The upcoming 10-year national strategy will drive Scotland's economic transformation as we recover from the pandemic. The Young Persons Guarantee will equip our young people with new skills so that they can flourish. Migration is also part of the solution.
And you need to wind up now, Ms Stevenson.
The UK government must face reality and take a rational approach before the damage to our economy and communities increases. If not, devolve the powers now so that this Parliament can.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. I now call on Tess White to be followed by Alex Rowley again for 4 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I just start off with a point of order, Presiding Officer?
Point of order, Ms White.
Thank you. At the start of the Cabinet Secretary's debate, she actually said, I'm drawing the debate to a close. Hopefully that was a mistake rather than the Parliament actually not working and there's no debate today. So I just wanted to put that on record.
That is certainly not a point of order. I'd be grateful if you can continue with your speech,
okay,
Ms.
Thank
White.
You. Presiding Officer, as we continue to navigate our way through the COVID-19 pandemic, the blunt truth is that most developed economies are grappling with labour shortages. The pandemic and associated public health responses have had a profound impact on workforces and on working practices. This isn't unique to Scotland or the UK. Business leaders and policymakers around the world are assessing which levers to pull to remedy the situation as best they can. Those in the sectors worst affected by labour shortages recognise the problems they are experiencing have multiple causes. The Road Haulage Association, for example, told the Scottish Affairs Committee in November last year that the driver shortage that we face is nothing new. It existed before Brexit. It added that there is not one single lever that could have been pulled to sort this. The SNP Green government predictably is focusing its energy on blaming Brexit and the UK government's migration policies for Scotland's reduced workforce availability. And as usual, this is about constitutional grievance. But the pandemic has brought into sharp relief the pre-existing tensions and weaknesses that prevent economies from reaching optimum performance. As my colleague Liz Smith identified earlier, there are serious structural issues with the Scottish economy that long predate the pandemic and Brexit. The message that we repeatedly hear from the business community is that Scotland is being hampered by a significant and persistent skills gap. The gap goes back years, between 2015 and 2017, and we know from the Employer Skills Survey that the number of businesses in Scotland reporting skills gaps increased while there was a decline at the UK level. And more recently, the SNP failed to meet its commitment to deliver 30,000 new apprenticeships by 2020, impacting the pipeline of talent Scotland needs as its ageing population becomes economically inactive. Not to mention the dramatic fall in apprenticeship starts in the early months of the pandemic, which the CIPD says fell more sharply in Scotland than England. Presiding Officer, I've spent the last 30 years of my career matching people and skills with organisational demand. Our top priority should be on full employment. It requires the creation of good, sustainable jobs across all regions of the country. We need to give people the opportunity to reskill and upskill, and this needs to be demand-led. Take, for example, Scotland's digital sector. It creates around 13,000 new roles annually. Only around 5,000 new recruits are being produced each year through universities and apprenticeships. A massive shortfall. As the CBI argued last month in last month's budget announcements, we need to see greater ambition from the Scottish Government on upskilling and retraining, and it needs to start delivering. Presiding Officer, the world order changed profoundly as a result of the pandemic. The resilience demonstrated by businesses and workers over the past 2 years has been extraordinary. As we seek to recover from the pandemic, we need to focus on ways to help as many people as possible, and we need to see action. Scotland's economic growth and productivity depend on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms White. I now call on Alex Rowley to be followed by Fulton MacGregor. Again, 4 minutes, Mr Rowley.
Presiding Officer, in speaking of this debate today, I first want to acknowledge the devastating impact of Brexit on the Scottish and UK economies. I note the Conservative amendment removes any acknowledgement of the impact of the end to free movement on the Scottish economy, and I would only say burying your head in the sand and completely disregarding the impact of Brexit is as great a betrayal of the Scottish people today as was the entirety of the disingenuous Brexit campaign. So whilst beyond the scope of today's debate, it seems clear to me that there is a need for a wider discussion on immigration in general and the potential pros and cons for a separate Scottish immigration system brought under the control of this Parliament. But today I want to focus on a key sector where there is no doubt that Brexit is having an impact, but where the main underlying cause of recruitment and retention issues is poor pay and, crucially, unequal terms and conditions dependent on the employer. I am speaking about the social care sector and the terms of employment for those care workers employed by agencies to deliver health and social care through public sector contracts issued to private companies by public authorities and paid for by this government. I have talked with a number of contractors who have outlined the difficulties they're having in recruiting staff and the even greater difficulties in being able to retain those staff. And is it any wonder? Firstly, the rate of pay for the job, £10.2 an hour, does not come anywhere near to recognising the complexities and challenges of being a care worker. But it's about much more than the rate for the job. It is the fact that many of these carers are only paid for the time they are in the client's house. So if they are allocated a half hour for a client, they clock on when they enter the house and clock off when they leave, and do not clock on again until they are in the next client's house. I talked with one carer recently and she told me that she has to travel up to 20 minutes between clients and is not paid for any of the travelling time that she does. She confined herself working 8 hours a day and only being paid for 5 or 6 of those hours and is out the house 10 hours as she's required to take 2 hours of unpaid breaks within the day. Would this be acceptable to any worker? And is it any wonder we have a recruitment and retention problem in this key sector of our economy? For those carers who have to use their cars to get between clients whilst not paid for travelling time, they do get a mileage allowance, and care workers that I've spoken to tell me that's 25 pence per mile. MSPs are paid 45 pence per mile, as is much of the public sector. Yet these care workers, key workers in our economy, are paid much less with very poor terms and conditions. Can anyone justify this, or can anyone seriously tell potential recruits that care is a valid and valued career option? I think not. So whilst the Finance Secretary points to the figures at the UK Government, and rightly so, she surely must accept that the Scottish Government must first put their own house in order and ensure that workers being hired directly or indirectly to deliver key public services are treated with dignity and respect and are paid the rate for the job. The discrimination of care workers must stop if we have to tackle the underlying issues in care.
Thank you very much, Mr Rowley. I now call the final speaker in the open debate, Fulton MacGregor, around 4 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And it is a privilege to speak in this debate on an issue that affects every part of our country. And as others have said before me, we are approaching a crisis of labour and skill shortages. And though there are many factors playing a role in this, I believe the biggest one is the reckless choice to pursue a hard Brexit, especially during a global pandemic. Although, as we've seen just last night and over recent weeks, I don't think there's much that this Tory government have not done during a global pandemic. So many of our amazing sectors within the Scottish economy are reporting issues with the supply of labour and skills, and this has been exacerbated by both Brexit and, of course, the pandemic. This double attack on our economy is difficult to navigate, but the frustrating thing is that one of these factors could have been avoided. We asked in this chamber several times, even when the pandemic started, all parties, apart from the Conservatives, asked that that Brexit was at least, at the very least, put on hold. But Brexit was pushed on us by a Tory Westminster government in full knowledge of the effects it would have, coupled with the pandemic. And I believe, as others have said, this was a grave mistake. In Scotland, our food and drink sector is something we can be really proud of. However, it is suffering greatly from labour shortages. I recognise that encouraging migration, while very important, is not the sole solution to this widespread problem. And the Scottish Government is working productively with business and is acting in those areas within its responsibilities. However, this is a worrying time, with farming and seafood industries reporting extreme labour shortages. In August 21, FDF Scotland carried out a survey of Scottish food and drink businesses to find out more about the scale of the labour shortages crisis. 93% of respondents currently had job vacancies, 90% described their job vacancies as hard to fill, and 97% of respondents felt that they would struggle to fill vacancies in the future. These figures are stark and incredibly worrying. And also, like others have said, and I know Alex Rowley done likewise, but I also spoke to a local recruitment business owner, Gary Robinson, from Coatbridge, who runs Talent 365 in the town. And I'll quote directly from him, because he's working on the front line. And he said, "We are witnessing acute labour shortages across multiple sectors in Scotland. As businesses seek to rebuild from the pandemic and deal with the implications of Brexit, notably higher energy costs and costs of purchases or raw materials, this in turn is creating significant wage inflation, leaving many businesses with no option but to pass these costs on to their customers at a time when we are already seeing considerable inflationary pressures on the economy. Of a particular concern are labour shortages in the agricultural, logistics, hospitality, technology and manufacturing sectors, with employers reporting significant difficulties in recruiting the staff they need to operate their businesses successfully." That's my constituent and an owner, a business owner in my constituency, who's done a lot of good work in this area, and that's how he's feeling right now. Because, presiding officer, the truth is that industries don't want to just see blame or talk about the reasons why we are seeing these shortages. They want to see action now. The Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy includes investment of an additional £500 million over this Parliament to support new, good, fair and green jobs and to equip people with the skills to enter into and progress in them. We need to recognise that Scotland's current population growth is due to migration, and the UK Government must end its destructive policies which limit it. As you know, Presiding Officer, we have made repeated representations to the UK Government to put in place emergency changes to the UK immigration system to combat acute post-Brexit shortages. This is going unaddressed, and as usual, the UK Government just bury their heads in the sand, hoping this goes away. It will not, and action is needed now. Presiding Officer, in closing, that's why I'm voting for the Government motion today, and would ask that members across the chamber take this opportunity, you know, a unique opportunity, if you like, to do the same and demonstrate a united front in our resolve to deal with this crisis that is affecting every constituency in every corner of our country. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr McGregor. We now move to closing speeches, and I call Daniel Johnson 6 minutes, please, Mr Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And picking up perhaps from where Fulton McGregor just left off, I think, in a sense, there's been more unity in the chamber today than you might believe by looking at both the motion and the amendments which are written down. And indeed, in some ways, there's a stark contrast listening to what were clearly the pre-written parts of members' contributions and the bits where they're responding to the debate. Because I think there is an acknowledgement is that there's a number of issues that businesses are having to face because of COVID, because of other changes in the economy, and not least because of Brexit. And indeed, I think the most important point of consensus that Jim Fairley highlighted is the one bit that we all agree on in the text is that the businesses out there, the people working in the workforce, have shown incredible resilience over the last years. And actually, we need to pay tribute to them and perhaps listen to them a little bit more when we're addressing the solutions, rather than pretending that we have all of those solutions. But unfortunately, when it does come down to what has been written down, we've seen an all too familiar approach from the two parties of government that we have in here. One trying to claim that all the issues are to do with Brexit. And indeed, many of the issues are, but not all of them. And the other party saying that none of them are to do with Brexit in terms of what they've written. Just in a moment, if I could just finish that point. Because while I agree with much of what Liz Smith said, indeed, there was barely a word that she said. Unfortunately, when we look at the terms of their amendment and what it does to the government motion, it completely obliterates terms of Brexit. And you cannot look at the labour shortages that we see across this country, whether in Scotland, the rest of the UK, and not conclude that those shortages are that much worse here than they are in any other part of the world. And I'll give way to Fulton McGregor.
Fulton McGregor.
Yeah, I thank the member for giving way, but we not accept it's not about SNP members saying that it's all about Brexit and not recognising that COVID has been an issue. Would you not accept that one was avoidable? Brexit was avoidable. That has been a political decision, whereas COVID is a worldwide pandemic.
Daniel Johnson.
Well, I wouldn't disagree with that, but what I would ask the member to acknowledge is that there are other political decisions made over the last 10 years that have impacted our productivity, that have impacted our labour participation rate, that have impacted our skill shortages, and ultimately have an impact on the fact that our income tax receipts are growing more slowly than not just the UK average, but pretty much every single Scottish region is lagging pretty much every single other region of the UK. Those are the consequences of other political decisions. So our amendment does not remove Brexit. So the member, I'm afraid, I would just like to make a little bit of progress. If he acknowledges that point, he should vote for our amendment, which makes exactly those points. Because quite simply, it is not credible to claim that Brexit is the sole reason that we have labour shortages, because otherwise it's not just the rest of Europe, but America has shortages in truck drivers. And likewise, we have global supply chain problems. So we have to look much more broadly if we're going to seriously address these issues. And the Scottish Fiscal Commission's report, which has been alluded to by a number of members, is a critical intervention at an important time, highlighting the points that I've just raised in response to Fulton MacGregor. And we need a broad-based approach. But I would also just really like to highlight critically on the points raised by my colleagues Sarah Boyack and Alex Riley, because there is an issue here, I think, by over-reliance on immigration that I think ignores the fact that fundamentally we have had a situation where inequality and insecurity has been a feature of our jobs market for far too long. They're simply seeking to replace the lost migration workers as the sole solution completely ignores that point. Because fundamentally, that you have two ways of approaching shortages in the labour market. One can seek to bring more people into the labour market, or one can seek to invest in skills, invest in productivity, to boost the productivity and thereby the wages of the people that are already in that labour market. And I think that is best exemplified, or at least the worst and most egregious example, that is in social care, as highlighted by Willie Rennie and others. And just on the example that Alex Riley gave of the mileage rate that social care workers allowed, 26 pence. An MSP can claim 20 pence if they commute by bicycle. So we are barely paying social care workers more to travel by car than we're paying MSPs to travel by bike. I think that shows the inequality that we have in the Scottish labour market. But on top of that, we have huge regional inequalities. The differences between hourly output between Edinburgh and the lowest productive region in Scotland is 50%. If you look at just regions between Edinburgh and Dundee, a distance of 30 miles, you see an almost a third drop in terms of productivity. These are things that the Scottish Government has the ability to tackle. It has the levers in its competence to deal with skills, to support enterprise, to drive investment in infrastructure that can link our cities and places of work. And yet it chooses not to use them. It has consistently cut enterprise support. It has cut the skills budget. So absolutely, a number of members have highlighted the fact that these are political choices about pursuing Brexit as opposed to a more rational approach, or choices about improving support for businesses, investing in infrastructure, investing in enterprise support, which frankly this government has failed to do. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Johnson. I now call on Douglas Lumsden. Around 7 minutes, Mr Lumsden.
I'd like to start my contribution today in agreeing with the first part of the government's motion today, the resilience and innovation that employers and workers have shown through the pandemic and keeping much of our economy open should be recognised. And I also thank everyone who has played their part. Deputy Presiding Officer, labour markets across the world, as we've heard today, are undergoing significant pressures and changes. And the United Kingdom is no different to what we're seeing in the US, Europe, China and beyond. However, there are differences in the UK. There are differences right here at home thanks to 14 years of SNP inaction and failed economic policy. Our tax intake per person is lower than the rest of the UK. Our welfare bill is rising. Our working population is falling compared to the rest of the UK. And economic growth is lower than the rest of the UK. And our recovery is slower than the rest of the UK. No, I'll make some progress first, Mr. Fairley. As we have said in our amendment, this has been highlighted by forecast groups and must be addressed by this devolved government as a matter of urgency. But instead of attracting investment and higher paid jobs, this government seems intent to drive business away. Decisions like turning their back on the energy industry does nothing to reverse this decline. Another opportunity lost is the government's decision to block free ports in Scotland. We lose out while investment goes to England. Just on the end of this piece, the Mayor of Teesside said, "We have attracted investors who were originally looking at Scotland when some areas in Scotland were looking at freeport status. And when they decided not to move forward with the current UK freeport policy, they have actually abandoned Scotland." I'll take the intervention.
Cabinet Secretary.
The record, the member may know that the Treasury was committed to ensuring that there was a freeport or green port in Scotland before that was changed by the Scotland Office. We are engaged in discussions with them to ensure that Scotland is treated fairly, but I would remind the member that the UK Government has chosen to invest in ports in England to the detriment of Scottish ports.
Yeah. Mr Lumsden.
Well, Deputy Presiding Officer, I hope that's another U-turn we've seen from the SNP government, because so far they haven't engaged with the UK government like the other regions across England. So if that is now the case, then I welcome that news. Jobs and investment lost to Aberdeen, all because this devolved government want to pick a political fight, is a disgrace. This is another motion brought by this tired government attempting to pat itself on the back, but actually does the opposite. It highlights the incompetence of this government. Just like when Alex Salmond promised thousands of green jobs many years ago with the SNP, none of them have come to fruition. Members across the chamber have made some interesting points. The Cabinet Secretary, you know, I think we all agree that immigration does impact our economy, but so do many, many other factors. And as Daniel Johnson and Liz Smith points out, the economy has long-term underlying issues. They were long there long before Brexit or COVID. And, you know, the Cabinet Secretary ignored the intervention by Murdo Fraser about labour shortages in Europe and the Accor group of hotels in France who can't get staff. So obviously freedom of movement is not the only issue before places in France are having labour shortages. And as Liz Smith points out, the SNP ministers have refused to listen to businesses and failed to listen to Scottish Fiscal Commission and failed to invest in skills and productivity. I will give way.
Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful to the member for giving me. We really acknowledge that, yes, there may be shortages in hospitality on the continent, but they are worse here and they are worse because of Brexit.
Douglas Lumsden.
Well, if there's issues in France, how can it be, if they can't employ people, so how come you can tell it's worse here? It's not as if there's thousands of people lined up and they're being blocked by Brexit. That just simply isn't the case. But, you know, the big issue that Liz Smith pointed out again, you know, we heard at the Finance Committee today, is the weakness in tax revenue and the shortfall that's going to bring. And that is the big, serious issue caused by the long-term structural issues within our economy. I did actually agree with Michelle Thompson when she mentioned that we need to train Scottish workers to the highest possible standard. I completely agree with that. But Paul Swinney was right to highlight cuts to the skills budget. Just at the time when we need it, it's being taken away. And Jim Fairley says we need independence. Well, I have news for him. If he doesn't like Brexit, then the SNP's own economic advisor says that independence will be like Brexit times 10. So another huge area of failure from the Scottish Government is around productivity and automation. I've seen nothing from this government that will address this issue. And this is a long-term issue. Scottish Conservatives' top priority at the last election was employment. We want to create good, sustainable, well-paid jobs across all regions of Scotland. We want to give people hope and opportunity. We also promised unlimited apprenticeships for Scotland's young people. Our demand-led model for apprenticeships would ensure that funded places reflect employer need rather than unambitious SNP targets. We would expand funding for graduate apprenticeships and the choice and availability of one- or two-year foundation apprenticeships for S5 and S6 pupils. We would aim to boost the number of apprenticeships taken up by women and would ensure that the UK apprenticeship levy is fully used for apprenticeship funding in Scotland. The UK government's Kickstart scheme has been a great example of what a government can achieve when it's focused on the day job. New figures show that 100,000 young people have started new jobs through the Kickstart scheme, among them thousands of Scots who have been helped onto the first step of the career ladder. There's so much that can be done by this government to develop the existing talent here in this country so that we can boost our currently lagging productivity levels. There must be a real focus on workforce planning, skills, training and increasing the employee compensation of our essential workers. Scottish workers have had enough of warm words. I've seen other parts of the UK recover faster than us, or hearing platitudes from the Scottish Government but no action, or seeing our public services underfunded and our workers undervalued. It's time to stop playing politics with this issue and actually come up with some proposals of how Scotland can grow and flourish, rather than simply blaming Westminster for all their ills. They have had 14 years in power. It's time that they stepped up, took responsibility for the financial situation that Scotland is in. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lumsden. And I now call on the Minister to wind up the debate for around 9 minutes, please, Mr. Lockie.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I genuinely thank colleagues for their valuable and powerful contributions today that certainly reflect the importance of the issues that we are discussing. And I'd also like at the outset to also reiterate what's in our motion and has been reiterated by parties across the Chamber, that this Government recognises the resilience and innovation that employers across many sectors of our economy have demonstrated throughout the past year in response to what has been extremely challenging circumstances. Nevertheless, it is clear that businesses and employers need our support and the support of others to mitigate the impacts of the current shortages in the labour market. Labour shortages affect our nation's productivity, as many members have said. It affects business profitability, business growth, inflation, the country's finances, our economic success as a nation, and can also represent opportunities to get more people into employment. So, in short, labour shortages hold our country back. Now, the Cabinet Secretary outlined earlier the challenges facing Scotland's business community and our economy and society as a result of several factors. We know, as many have said, that the pandemic has been enormously disruptive, but also as a result of the cataclysmic, the reckless and monumentally foolhardy decision to remove Scotland from the European Union against our will.
Liz Smith.
Several SNP MSPs have said today that there was a decision, a political decision for Brexit. Would he acknowledge that the decision about Brexit, and I disagree with Brexit, but it was a democratic decision by the British people, including many in Scotland and including many in the SNP? We have to accept it.
Minister.
Well, what we accept is that Scotland's Parliament and the people of Scotland in a referendum rejected Brexit, and it's been foisted on us against our democratic will. But not only that, and this is key to this debate, it was foisted on Scotland at the worst possible time and in the worst possible way for Scotland against the backdrop of a pandemic and other ongoing pressures. Like demographic trends, with an ageing population and a declining birth rate, all of which mean the loss of freedom of movement, the erection of those barriers, the tightening of immigration, are the last thing that our economy needs, given that that alone is projected to lead to a 3 to 5% reduction in the working age population in Scotland. Themes that many colleagues have eloquently explored, albeit some members, particularly Conservative benches, seem to live in an alternative reality, who simply brush these issues under the carpet and don't want even to talk about Brexit, as Donald Cameron said during his speech, because, of course, it's such a fiasco and so damaging, we can understand why the Conservatives don't want to talk about Brexit. But in the real world, of course, across the Scottish economy, employers have been reporting a combination of skills and labour shortages, which are impacting on the provision of their goods and services. Well, 38.3% of Scottish businesses reported experiencing a shortage of workers in November. These shortages are even more substantial in specific sectors, including accommodation and food services and transportation and storage. And though some of these issues are not new, as many members have said, Brexit and the pandemic-related disruption have severely increased their scale. And less than 2 years on from Brexit, it's clear that its impact on the Scottish labour market has been disastrous, particularly for industries that have traditionally relied on EU workers. Brexit has significantly reduced the ability of businesses to source non-domestic labour, which makes up around 8% of Scotland's workforce, and is higher in particular sectors such as hotels and restaurants. And over the last 2 years, the national insurance number registration for overseas nationals in Scotland have fallen by around 75%. Think about that for a second. Down by three quarters. It is preposterous to disassociate that startling statistic from Brexit or from the UK government's hostile immigration policy. Daniel Johnson.
I'm very grateful and I'm sorry to Liz Smith. I agree that it's preposterous, but it's a fact and it's not going away anytime soon. So does the Minister not acknowledge that whether we agree on this point or not, the solution is about flexibility and skills and trying to get people out of work into those jobs as efficiently as possible?
In concluding, Minister.
Of course, these solutions are being looked at and have to be looked at, but the damage caused by Brexit is fixed. And many of the tools for fixing the damage caused by Brexit lie with the UK government. And that's why Brexit is such an important part of this debate. And it's not just Brexit. COVID's impact on further reducing migration to Scotland has worsened these issues, leaving businesses struggling to attract enough staff and skilled workers across the economy. But again, you can't divorce COVID from Brexit, because what we're being told by employers, and the Conservative Party should listen to Scotland's employers, is that people who have left to go home because of COVID are not coming back to Scotland because of Brexit. I'll give way.
I thank him very much for giving way. When it comes to listening to employers, would he care to remember that the business community is telling us very bluntly that many of the issues that they're facing just now are part of the issues about productivity, about growth, about investment, and that these are Scottish-related problems, not to do with the UK?
Minister.
Of course, there's various problems facing the labour market in Scotland at the moment, and some of which we are addressing as a government here in this country. But others require the UK government to waken up to the damage that's been caused by Brexit and use the tools they have available to help us repair the damage and address the labour shortage in Scotland. And one of the biggest sectors suffering at the moment, of course, is Scotland's food and drink industry, which is now facing crippling staff shortages. And Seafood Scotland has said that around 15% of jobs in larger factories are unfilled, with 63% of seafood processors experiencing staff shortages and fears the situation will get worse. So much for the sea of opportunity promised by the Conservative Party to our fishing communities in this country. And the Chief Executive of Scotland Food and Drink, James Withers, recently reported that one business was forced to forego up to £15 million worth of contracts because they did not have the staff to fulfil orders. And replicate that right across the Scottish economy, and you can see the cost to our economy that Brexit is causing. And let me further reiterate the impact that Brexit has had through illustrating its effects on agriculture as well. This past year has been a particularly difficult time for agriculture, as the industry has struggled to cope, as Jim Fairley said, with the issues that the UK's exit from the EU has created, such as the additional paperwork and reduced labour supply for planting and harvesting crops. In the softened fruit veg industry alone, businesses have reported an average of 20% shortfall in seasonal agricultural workers. And with the uncertainty over labour, growers have had to walk away from the industry whilst others have reduced production. Another economic cost to rural communities and Scotland. Now, on Christmas Eve, the UK government announced an extension of the seasonal worker visa route to the end of 2024 with a statement that the industry must transition to domestic workers. Well, that got a big damp squib from the National Farmers Union of Scotland. Their quotes, and apparently, you know, the Conservative Party says nothing to do with Brexit, but the farmers themselves said that on Christmas Eve, the government has given Scotland's food and drink veg industry deeply disappointing news. Government plans to start tapering the scheme down from 2023 shows a complete disconnect from the industry. Plans to start dismantling the scheme are a blow and means some very difficult decisions will have to be made about future production. So yes, there are things we can do as the Scottish Government, but the damage that's been imposed by the UK Government in terms of Brexit, they have the tools to try and fix now, and we're asking them to work with the Scottish Government and try and fix some of that damage. Otherwise, more damage will be inflicted on the Scottish agricultural sector. But as I come to a close, Presiding Officer, I just want to say, in terms of what the Scottish Government is doing, we're going to develop a talent attraction programme, a migration service to attract workers with the skills that Scotland needs. We've made constructive proposals to the UK Government, including for 24 and 36-month visas and additions and structural changes to the shortage occupation list and another of other measures as well. But we want the UK Government to work with us. That's why we are proposing a joint task force with the devolved administrations and the UK Government. This is a very serious situation for the Scottish and UK economy. It's a very serious situation for Scotland's business community. So please, for the UK Government, our message is work with us, help us get this sorted and repair the damage caused by Brexit and address the staff shortages that are undermining this country's success, and support the motion.
That concludes the debate on addressing the impact of labour shortages on Scotland's economy. It is now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of a legislative consent motion. And I ask Marie Goujon to move motion number 2739 on Animal Welfare Kept Animals Bill UK legislation.
Moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 2755 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to this week's business. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion. Thank you, Minister. No member is asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, the question is that motion 2755 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. And there are four questions to be put as a result of today's business. And can I remind members that if the amendment in the name of Liz Smith is agreed to, the amendment in the name of Paul Sweeney will fall. The first question is that amendment 2740.1 in the name of Liz Smith, which seeks to amend motion 2740 in the name of Kate Forbes on addressing the impact of labour shortages on Scotland's economy, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we will move to a vote and there will be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.